Good morning.
Good morning.
We gather this morning in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please join in our call to worship, scripture sentences from Matthew 17. A voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, whom I love. Listen to him." With those who are able to stand as we sing our insert hymn, "Sing of God Made Manifest." With me as we pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, as we gather, we thank you for that great summary of the past season that we've been through, this season of the Sundays after Epiphany, where we've been thinking about how God was manifest, revealing himself. You were revealing yourself in your true anointed one, the true prophet for us, for all of humanity, Jesus Christ. And we're preparing to turn to focus on him as our true priest who will offer up the right and true sacrifice on Good Friday. And then we look forward to our celebration of him as king as we celebrate his resurrection and then ascension to your right hand. But we gather as those who recognize in the man Jesus, your true anointed one, our prophet, our priest, our king, your very son, God from God, light from light. And we come as those who are putting our full trust in him and what he accomplished for us, and are resting our lives and receiving the gift of salvation that he offers. For we gather this morning in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Just take a moment to turn around and wave at the people around you, and then you may be seated. Again, good morning and welcome to everyone who's here. Right early in the morning, Dave Lundy said to me, "You think anyone will show up?" And I said, "I think they will. I think there'll be people even in this cold who showed up." And for those who are watching at home, we have a fairly decent crowd today here watching on a very cold Sunday morning. But we're glad that you're joining us as well over Facebook Live and that we're together in the spirit to worship. Looking at our announcements for this morning, we were set to install the Board of Christian Ed today, but too many of them were not going to be able to make it, so we're going to do that in a couple of weeks, so that won't be going on today. And normally we would have been having our Valentine's dinner today, but given the way the situation is, we're not having it. But you can still give to support the Board of Christian Ed if you like, both by sending in your gift, giving online, or giving here at the church. Other things happening, this is Transfiguration Sunday as well as Valentine's Day, and that's the sign of the end of the seasons of the Sunday after Epiphany, Sundays after Epiphany, and a turn this Wednesday towards Lent. And as I intimated in the, or suggested in the prayer, it's easy to think of Epiphany when he's revealing God as Christ as prophet. Lent, as we're turning to his death on the cross and him offering up himself as the sacrifice as our priest, and then his resurrection and ascension as Christ as our king. So we're making this turn now to Jesus as our true priest. We've been thinking about him as our true prophet. And that begins this Wednesday. Our plan is to have the service, if the snow and everything doesn't keep us from that. And we're going to have communion the way we've been doing it, not by dipping it in the chalice, what we call intinction, because of the current situation. But the council did decide to go ahead and have us offer ashes, but they are asking that anyone who would like to have ashes has to be masked, and as we line up, we have to stay 6 feet apart, and we'll do it very quickly. So we will allow ashes for those who would have them. Again, this is not something you have to do. It's no Christian obligation anyway. It's for yourself that you're doing it as a reminder. The words given to you are, remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And so this thing is not something we're doing to earn points with God or anything like that. It's just something we're doing as a part of our seeking to raise our awareness of our need for what Christ has accomplished for us at Good Friday and by dying for us. So that'll be this Wednesday. We will also live stream that. Dave has graciously volunteered to be here Wednesday at 7 so that those who are not able to make it will be able to participate in the service that way. Also, this Saturday, we'll be having our men's study. We've been doing that by video conference call, and the link for that is in the bulletin. We found out last month a feature of Google Meet, which we use, is that it has excellent real-time closed captioning. So if you have a hard time hearing, it's also very good. You can hear what the other people are doing. It was amazing. Mike Evans, who was in Florida and who joined us, he couldn't get his audio to work, but he stayed with us because he could read what we were saying and be a part of the study. We're continuing our study of the Holy Land revealed, and we're getting into the New Testament times now, so that's been quite interesting. And then finally, we are looking for an AV equipment technician. If you know someone who is techie, they don't have to know this software or know how to do these things here. We were looking for someone who is adept at software and technical equipment and has a passion for it. It'd be great to find someone like Dave who's super passionate about it and puts 110% into it. But if you know of someone, please point them our way. The job description may be found at the church website, and that's a part-time position, paid position here at the church to continue doing these live streams and helping with the 11:30 service. Any other announcements that we should especially highlight this morning? Did talk to Richard Straub this week, and his back surgery was successful. He said that immediately he could begin to see, well, Susan's here, not long after that his legs were feeling better, and that was where it was really the problem. So he recognized that that solved that. He's got a lot of pain from the surgery itself, and that's where the pain's coming from, but he's very optimistic that the actual problem has been dealt with, and so he just has 6 to 8 weeks to recover. So we praise God for that. Did also talk with Pat Schneider, and she's returned home and is doing a lot better, so we're thankful for that. But continue to pray for her that she might get her strength back. She's lost even more weight and had pneumonia and was in just very wiped out, so she needs our prayers as she's getting her strength back. But she's doing that at home. Any other joys to celebrate today? Yes, Anne.
Trey and Alicia,
is that how you say her name?
Yeah.
Got engaged last night. Well, congratulations to the couple, yeah. That's the Farney's grandson, Trey. Many. Any other joys? Concerns, do add to your prayer concerns, Andrea Williams' mother. She's in the hospital, or was in the hospital last week, had all the signs of having an infection, but were not able to, and symptoms related to that, not able to find that source of those symptoms. And then now she's been in Encompass, and things haven't changed for her there. So they definitely, she definitely needs our prayers, and the family's very concerned for her. So we'll be praying for Andrea Williams' mother. Yes. Betty, Bill calls it the big house. Yes. Right. I still haven't told him that you said anything, so.
No, I
okay. So you let the cat out of the bag, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yes.
You know what? They won't strap you in a wheelchair, so she keeps trying to get up and fall. That's not good. Preacher man should talk to him about that.
They would listen to me, right? Any other concerns? Also, do continue to pray for Alice Lynn as she's recovering and undergoing therapy. Any other concerns to highlight? Would you bow with me as we pray? Well, God, as we come to you, we come in response to the revelation you have made. Through the prophet Moses said would come. He said a prophet like myself would come, and when he comes, you're to listen to him. The very thing that you said on the mountain when Moses and Elijah disappeared, and it was only Jesus. You said, this is my son, listen to him. And we listen to him as our prophet, our guide, our shepherd, who leads us and guides us into all truth. And he's the one who taught us to pray, to bring to you our concerns, to know that you care for us such that the very hairs of our head, he said, are numbered, that you are the one who answers prayer, that we're to ask, to seek, to knock, to keep doing it, to persevere like the people in the parables that he taught us about, the widow and the friend at midnight, and to not give up, to be constantly praying and turning to you, and we would receive grace in the hour of our need, and that indeed you would give us the greatest gift of all, the gift of your presence in the person of the Holy Spirit. And so as we're turning to you now, Lord, we know that we have the things we ask of you because we're asking right now things according to your will, for Jesus embodied perfectly your will, and it is your will, he said, to give us the Holy Spirit. And we know then that we have that presence in our lives if we turn to you and ask for it. We turn to you also in obedience to the apostles, that he said, if they receive you, they've received me. And it was your apostles who taught us to pray for all people, and especially those in authority. And so we pray for the nations, the world around us, oh God, as we're thinking today about love on Valentine's Day, and in our sermon especially, this reality of Christian love embodied in the life of Jesus. We see a world that still is so bitterly divided and filled with the human hatred that filled the earth prior to the days of Noah. When Noah was alive and the flood happened, and the heart change didn't happen after the flood, and something more profound had to happen, and you sent your son. And yet, Lord, so many have not received that message, do not live and walk in that love that is ours to receive and grow in day by day. And we pray, Lord, that that would be the case, that your church would embody that love that would reflect the rays of who Christ is out into the world, and that people would be drawn to that light and receive that transformation that only you can give, that heart change that is only possible through what he offered up as priest in breaking down the barrier between us and you, that we might have this presence known as the Holy Spirit, who inscribes on our hearts this letter from yourself, that we are letters of Christ, that you are writing on our hearts, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of clay, through the Spirit, a transformed, changed life. We pray, Lord, for those who are involved in the governments among us who have that life change, that they would be given places of influence in government to influence people towards your true purposes, and that they would speak to the powers that be, and at times even speak bluntly and boldly, as Paul says in our reading for today, that we who have this hope, we speak boldly the truth. And we pray that you would give them boldness and that they would influence our country for the good. Help us in the places we've been set, O God, to influence and be bold in our speech and to speak up for what is right, what is good, what is true, what is righteous, and what is pleasing to you, O God. May we not become fearful because of the present time in which we live, but may it make us all the more bold to stand out for you and to be different, that we might make a difference. We rejoice, Lord, in all the blessings that we've received in this life, and we thank you as we're thinking about this cold weather that's coming, that we have warm homes, we have cupboards and pantries that are filled, we have reliable vehicles. But that reminds us, O Lord, that there are people who don't have these things, those who are going to seek shelter at one of the shelters, those who are relying upon food banks, those whose vehicles are very unreliable at best, if they run at all in cold weather. And we pray, Lord, that the needs of those who suffer like this might be met. If we know of someone like that, Lord, help us to reach out. For as John will say, as I'll quote in our sermon today, if we see a person in need that is our brother and sister and we don't help them, how can the love of God that was in Christ be in us? And we thank you, Lord, for those who have been doing that this week, who have been reaching out to shut-ins, to older people, to those in need, and helping to supply their need, that they might be prepared for this upcoming storm and this deep cold snap that we're going through, and helping to protect those who are the vulnerable among us. And we pray, Lord, that you would renew us in that commitment to be that person we can be to the people you put in our way. For the person who is the neighbor is the one who acts as the neighbor to the person in our path. And we pray, Lord, that you would keep us aware to the people that come into our path, that you place in our path, that we might have the blessing of giving. For it is more blessed to give than to receive. And may we act in that way, O God. We seek to do that right now in our prayers for the people on our prayer list, to give our time and effort in prayer for them, and thanking you already for the sign of recovery in Richard's life, and that this procedure seems to have done what the doctor has felt afterwards, that it was successful, and there are already signs of that. We pray, Lord, for his full recovery. We intercede, O Lord, on behalf of Andrea's mother. We pray, Lord, that you would send to them the right person who would see and understand her situation, use the right testing method, whatever needs to be done to determine the source of these symptoms, and that these symptoms would be defeated, and that the source would be overcome, and there would be a full recovery for her, Lord. We pray, Lord, that your peace, which transcends all situations, would guard their hearts and their minds, and her mind, as they seek to be an advocate for her, to talk to the people that need to be talked to. Give them wisdom, O Lord, as they seek to walk with her at this time. We pray, Lord, for her recovery. We thank you for Betty's being back now at North River and getting therapy. We thank you for Pat's being home. We thank you for Alice's therapy that she's receiving right now. Thank you for the many ways in which you're working through other people to be a blessing to us, and through their efforts, their skills, their knowledge, their backgrounds, we find ourselves blessed and made more whole. And in that way, they reflect to us your true purpose for us as revealed in Jesus, who went about healing and doing good to others. We rejoice, Lord, with Trey and his fiance. We pray the best for them, Lord. We pray, Lord, that your blessing would be upon them. And as we're thinking about Valentine's Day and that call that you made us male and female, and it was your purpose that we would be drawn together in relationships of love, that we pray that not only the romantic love that often is that which first draws people to each other, but this deeper love that we'll be thinking about today would be manifest in their relationship, and that they would grow in it as they turn to you, O God, made known in Christ, who transforms us through that relationship we have with him into the loving creatures you meant us to be. We pray all these things, Lord, lifting up whatever unspoken concerns or concerns I may have forgotten into your hands. And we pray, Lord, all these things in unity with our Savior and our Lord Jesus, joining together and praying the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time we'll have our special music, Love Can Build a Bridge, and today it is Andrea's father, Stan, who's with us, and Pam Shook, who will be joining her.
Swim out to save you in your sea of broken dreams. When all your hopes are sinking, let me show you what love means.
Love can build a bridge between your heart and mine. Love can build a bridge. Don't you think it's time? Don't you think it's time?
I would whisper love so loudly, every heart could understand that love and only love can join the tribes of men. I would give my heart's desire so that you might see the first step is to realize that it all begins with you and me.
Love can build a bridge between your heart and mine. Love can build a bridge. Don't you think it's time? Don't you think it's time? When we stand together, it's our finest hour. We can do anything,
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 anything.
We keep believing in the power. Love can build a bridge between
just goes perfectly with the sermon today, so that's wonderful. Thank you very much. This time we have the opportunity to present our gifts to God, the gifts that we've brought today, the gifts that came in by mail, the gifts that were given online, that we're giving to support this word that brings us the reality of Christ, and through Christ, the Spirit who begins to write on our hearts the new life and to form us into the character of Christ. And so as we give these gifts, we stand together who are able, thanking God for all of his blessings to us. Once more, we thank you, God, for all of the blessings that we've come to know in this life. And again, at this time, we're especially mindful of the warm home that we've been given, the food that we have, transportation, the people that we can spend time with when we're snowed in the home, people who check on us and care for us. We thank you, Lord, at this Valentine's Day for the gift of human love, that it was your idea. And we thank you for the gift of a person that we're drawn to, attracted to, and that we love. But we thank you most of all that when we were our most unlovely and when we're the most unattractive, you still loved us. And while we were yet sinners, your Son came and he died for us, not because of anything that was in us that would have drawn you to us, but because of who you are, that you are love. And that's how we know what love is, by what he did for us. And so it's for the working of this greater knowledge, of this love that is greater than all of our sin, that we dedicate these gifts today in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, again, this is Transfiguration Sunday, the last Sunday in the Sundays after Epiphany is always this climax of Jesus revealing who God is. And of course, he shines from the inside out. So it's pointing to his inner character as what is the great revelation of who God is. And our first reading is going to be from 2 Corinthians, where Paul likens what's going on with Jesus to that moment on Mount Sinai, the first mountain, where God showed himself to Moses. But that effect on Moses was an outer change that faded and went away. The effect that Jesus has on us through the Spirit is a greater effect. It's an inward transformation that doesn't go away. So we don't have to veil ourselves, hide ourselves like Moses did, because we have something that lasts, whereas Moses did not. Hear now the word of God as is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And as we prepare to hear it, would you bow with me in prayer? Father, we thank you for this word that brings to us the realities that we're talking about today, that when we turn to Christ, the veil is taken away and we see that the whole of Scripture is about him, and that when we're in his presence, we are being ourselves transformed by one from one degree of glory to the next through that Spirit that comes to us in him. And so once more, we come expecting that this will be a transformative moment as we listen to and hear your word, for we receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Beginning in verse 12, Paul writes, "Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. But their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. It has not been removed because only in Christ is it taken away. Even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Here ends the epistle lesson. The gospel lesson is Mark's account of the Mount of Transfiguration. We'll begin reading in verse 2 of chapter 9. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Here ends our gospel lesson. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Thanks be to God. I invite the children present, we've got a few today, to come forward. And again, if you'll sit back, we'll have our children's message. I have with me today a picture of one of my, a picture of one of my favorite places. Let me get back to it. It's a place we go to actually quite often. I think we go there more than anywhere else. Here I had it all set up. I thought, oh, I won't have to print it off. I'll just, but I know exactly where it's at. So let me find it for you. And you might guess what place it is based on our reading for today, especially the gospel lesson. It's down south from here. It's in Tennessee. And we go there and we have to drive up into it to be able to really enjoy it. Here we are. And there it is. That's a picture up there on the Smoky Mountains. I need to get back a little bit more, but do you see that? Have you ever been to the Smoky Mountains? Oh, it's really fun to go to the Smoky Mountains. I like going there because it's just that up in the mountains on a trail like that when you're by yourself and you're enjoying the beauty of the world. In fact, there's a picture of me enjoying the beauty of the world up there. You just really feel relaxed and at peace. And in a strange way, you do kind of feel closer to God in that there's the beauty of the world around you, and you're way up high. Because one of the ways we think about God is we think about him as being far above us, right? He's far above us. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. He's far above us. And you know, in the ancient world, that's how they thought of God as well. The big word for that is he's transcendent. He's greater than this world. He's bigger than this whole world. And so the place where people often would go to meet God was on a mountain. Not just the Israelites, but all kinds of people around them. And God used that idea as a way of showing himself to people. First, he did that when Moses in Exodus 34 goes up on Mount Sinai. Did you even notice that Mark makes it a point to say he was up on a very high mountain? He wanted them to think about that. They're way up high. And so they go up on that mountain to meet God. And it's on that mountain where they're shown once and for all where you go to meet God. Now, Moses and Elijah were there. They represented the law and the prophets, the whole of the Old Testament. And of course, we find God in the whole of the Old Testament. But what was being shown to them there is if you really want to understand the Old Testament, there's one person who has all of the answers for unlocking and knowing the Old Testament. And so Moses and Elijah go away, and there's one person left, and God says, "This is my son. Listen to him." And the whole point of the story is saying, We're up on the place where you go to meet God, and now we're being told, here's where you go if you want to know God. You go to Jesus. He's the one who unlocks the knowledge of God, who shows us the life and character of God. And you know, it said that he's shown from the inside. You know, he radiated. There's a Bible verse that says of women that their beauty shouldn't be of outer adornment, but of their inner self, which is of great value to God, Peter said. That's 1 Peter 3. The beauty of a person, 1 Peter 3 says, should be their inner self. And the fact that he radiates light from within is saying the beauty and glory of Jesus is who he is and how he acts. You know, we have no real pictures of Jesus to know what he looked like. All pictures, those are just things people made up. But the picture we do have of Jesus is the kind of person he was. And that's what makes us be drawn to him. He had the beauty of an inner self. And the word we use for that, we're going to talk about it, is the word we're thinking about today on Valentine's Day. I bet that's why you're wearing red, right? Because it's Valentine's Day. And the word we use for that is love. Love. We're going to talk about this in the sermon. John says, one day we're going to see him. We don't know what we're going to be like, but when we see him, we're going to be like him. That's 1 John 3. And it's in 1 John 3 that he says, and this is what we know what love is. Christ laid down his life for us. So he's showing us to be like Jesus is to be filled with love. It's to embody and radiate love from your inner being. But, as they just sang, we need love, but we don't love as humans. And that's where the Bible said today, the place to get love is by having the Spirit come into your life through Jesus and begin to change you and to make you love in ways you couldn't love on your own. So that as you meet Jesus on a regular basis, he's changing you from the inside out, writing it on your hearts. He's going to say, you become a letter of Jesus. 2 Corinthians 3:3. You become a letter of Jesus to other people as he's writing his truth, not on stone, but on your life. Tablets of flesh, he says. Let's thank God for that. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of love, but we confess that as humans, we don't love like we should. That's why we have songs saying, let's love. We should be loving. And thank you that you give us the answer to the fact that we don't love. You sent us the true embodiment of love to radiate that love into our hearts, that it might change us slowly but surely to be more and more like him. And so it's in the name of the one who is your very Son, God from God, light from light, that we say this prayer in his holy name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. I invite those who are able to stand as we sing number 633, Open Our Eyes, Lord. Remain standing as together we confess our faith. We'll be doing so in the words printed in our bulletin, that great creed, the Nicene Creed, which lays out clearly that Jesus is the true expression of God. Christians, what do we believe? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen, We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy, universal Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Be seated. Our preaching text this morning is the first verse of the epistle lesson. Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We might add the last verse, verse 2 of chapter 4. Setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience. Would you bow with me as we pray? Lord, we do ask once more that the words that I speak and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. For we ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, there's a new phenomenon in the land. It's been going on for a few years now. You might have heard this phrase, cancel culture. Oftentimes it happens mainly to famous people, celebrities and people, for things they say, missteps they make, and suddenly they've lost their job and they've lost opportunities to do the things that they used to do. A related phenomenon is deplatforming someone. And the most famous deplatforming of someone was of President Trump when he was banned for life from Twitter. But it actually came pretty close to home here not that long ago when one of our local pastors, Pastor Kirk Horstmeier at Emmanuel Lutheran, just over there across the highway on Volkman Road, was deplatformed from Facebook for one of the devotionals he gives on a regular night. He was giving a devotional. Someone familiar with it said he thought it was because of comments that were being made underneath in his devotional, not for anything he was saying in the devotional. But still, his devotional was taken down and his account was suspended. I don't think it's suspended anymore. And yet, there it was. Something that's been happening all around the country and oftentimes with big name people is happening right here in our own area to someone that many of us know and someone not too far from us. And it really brought home that we're encountering a phenomenon at this time when people are finding it hard to do what Paul was saying Christians do. Christians speak boldly and they set forth the truth plainly, commending themselves to every man's conscience. You know, I've been trying to think about why is it this is going on right now. Something that was very influential for me is one of my first courses in seminary was a course in theological research methods where we were learning to write papers. And we studied a book and this person said, before you can disagree with someone, you need to first show that you understand. So you need to be able to lay out that you understand why they're doing what they're doing. So that was just a good succinct way for me to think about, now how do you go about disagreeing with someone? So I wanted to understand, why are we having this cancel culture and this deplatforming of people? And I got to thinking back to our trip to Germany, going to Munich. Munich, of course, is in southern Germany, in Bavaria. And every time we go someplace, Sue is our complete travel agent. She figures it all out. She always figures out having someone give us a tour of the city. There's various people who do this in each city we go to. And when you go and you travel and you go through Munich, one of the things you realize is not only are you looking at beautiful buildings from the past, but you also are learning history from not that long ago, because it was in Munich and in Bavaria that National Socialism really began. And so many of the places that you would go and stand, you were going and standing at a place where Hitler spoke. There's a place right now, you can see a picture of it, and picture of Hitler standing there speaking. And to this day, they'll have meetings there, but the chancellor will never stand in that spot. She'll go stand over in a different spot, because they don't want to stand where he stood. And a place that oftentimes people go to, a very famous place in Munich, is the Hofbrauhaus, a beer hall. And the Hofbrauhaus is a big old beer hall, but also one of the things that you learn there is that Hitler spoke there, that was the social media of their day, that if you wanted to go and you wanted to get your message out, you would go and have it at a beer hall, and that's where they would have, and it was not far from there where he had the beer hall pushed, where they tried to overthrow the government, not long, there's a street right down from the Hofbrauhaus where all of that happened. You can look at the pictures of it. And when the phenomenon of Donald Trump happened in 2016, what you had off almost immediately in the editorial pages of the New York Times and other places were these references to Hitler. And what seemed to like to most people as just a businessman acting in a very businessman-like way, used to getting your way and acting with a kind of authoritarian way where you would say, well, this is how we're going to do it, which is different from a politician. Many people began to say, oh, no, is this the ugly authoritarianism of Hitler arising? And I got to thinking, why did they go so quickly to that? And why is it that we always go to Germany and we don't think about the terrible things that happened in the Soviet Union? Many more died there, or the terrible things under, you know, the Khmer Rouge, or under even the Rwandan genocide. And I think so oftentimes people go to Germany because people feel Germany is very similar to our culture and life here, that's an educated people, a people that have all of the values that we have, and a people who've produced such great art and wonders of the world. You think of all the German-speaking people. I know Mozart was from Austria. We visited where he was from right there in Salzburg. And yet, Mozart was a German-speaking person, Beethoven, Bach. I mean, you could just think of all these great people. When I was in seminary, you could take a course in theological German, because almost all of the great thinkers who wrote in the early 20th century were all Germans. And if you wanted to study their language or their books in the original language, you had to know some of the language to be able to do it. And so I think what happened is many people think, well, if it happened there and they're very much like us, it could happen here. Now, I'm not arguing one way or another what your feelings about Donald Trump. I think people make their case either way. Many people just say he was just acting as a businessman. He was acting as a way a businessman acts. They're used to getting their way, and they just act in kind of an authoritarian kind of way. Others went straight to... Now, I personally, you know, Hitler pretty much signaled from the beginning who he was. You know, you read Mein Kampf. He wrote that before all this happened. He pretty much laid it out. And one of the places we visited when we were in Munich area is we went to Dachau, the camp not far from there. And that was his first camp. He set it up right after he got into power. And he was sending people there immediately, people who weren't Jewish. It was just mainly political enemies and others. And so he really emphasized, I mean, Hitler was Hitler, you know, and I think... But I don't want to get into the political end of that. What I want to get into is the fact is that what has happened is that there are some people who see anyone who was a supporter of Donald Trump as almost the equivalent of a Nazi, right? And then on the other hand, you have the people who see those people now as wanting to shut down anyone who was a supporter of Donald Trump as a totalitarian themselves by trying to rob people of the ability to dissent. And so both groups now are filled with a sense of fear that either side wants to take over and control the other and impose its will on the other. And we live in a time of great fear. I think that what's driving both sides, you know, it was fear that caused the Washington Post to adopt this little tag under democracy dies in darkness. I mean, they thought this was the end of democracy, and many people really thought that. And on the other hand, now that's what people on the other side are thinking. Democracy's dying because free speech is being taken away.
And it's the middle of all of this that Paul says, we speak boldly. And no one's going to stop us from speaking boldly because the source of our boldness isn't fear. The source of our boldness is hope. And what is that hope? Remember what my Bible college professor said, whenever you see a therefore, find out why it's therefore. And what's the therefore? It means what went before it. He said, if what was fading away came with glory, that was Moses up on the mountain. See, what Moses was doing when he covered his face is he was hiding from the Israelites the fact that the old covenant wasn't a lasting thing. It was a time-limited thing. In fact, Paul says, they're still in the clueless about that. They still think that somehow that was supposed to continue on, and it hasn't been fulfilled and going forward in Jesus. But if that which was temporary was filled with glory, he says in verse 11, how much greater is the glory of that which lasts? And that last word, lasts, is the key to our hope. We have that which lasts forever. And because we know we have that which lasts forever, that's what we focus on, that's what we emphasize, that's what we preach, that's what we speak plainly, that's which we never back down on, because all these other things come and they go. I know some way down the road they're going to look back and say, wow, that was kind of a crazy time when they were doing all that. Just like we look back at the 80s when there were all these people who supposedly had these repressed memories of being abused by satanic ritual cults. Go back and study. There's been whole studies done on this phenomenon of mass hysteria that happened all across the United States where people were saying they had repressed memories of being taken by satanic cults and sexually abused, and they found out that psychologists were drawing this out of people and causing them to think that way, and it's a study in mass hysteria. And we're living in a time where both sides are at such an agitated state that I think we'll look back and we'll say, that was a really a strange time that we were living through. But what do we hold on to in the midst of a strange time like that? It doesn't mean we don't speak our mind, that we don't try to influence politics a certain way, but that's not what we are holding on to, and that's not what our main focus in life is. The main focus in life should be on that which is going to transcend this moment in history. And that which is going to transcend this moment in history is that which lasts. But what is it that he's talking about that lasts? He's first talking about the glory that was in Moses. The glory that was in Moses was a temporary thing. Well, what was it? He was up on the mountain, and his external person was radiating from the glory of having been with God. But the thing is, it was on his external person. And when he would come down from the mountain, that glory would go away. And he didn't want them to see. It was kind of a shameful thing to say, this thing it's not really a lasting thing, and he would hide it from them. And they were veiled from the fact that this is only a temporary thing. The lasting thing is the glory that appeared in Jesus. And what is the glory that appeared in Jesus? That which radiated from his inner being. John said it this way, we beheld his glory, full of grace and truth. What is that describing? That's describing him as a person. He embodied in his life the glory, and the glory was the love that he expressed in the world for the world. The word for it is love. As John says in 1 John 3, dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. We don't even yet know what it's going to be like to be who we're going to be. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in them purify themselves just as he is pure. Then in that same chapter, he says, we know we have passed from death to life, because we love each other. See, that's pointing to us to what it is that we're going to be like when we see Jesus. We're going to be embodying perfect love. And the glory that was in Jesus was perfect love. And that glory is not a temporary thing that fades away. Again, remember, Paul said only three things last. Only three things will ever remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of those three things is love. That love that was embodied in Jesus Christ is that which we're bold to live for and to preach and to emphasize in the midst of a world of fear and division and mistrust and hatred. We focus on that which lasts and remains and is there forever. And how does this glory take place? You see, Moses was up on the mountain, and that being with God on the mountain caused his external person to be transformed. When he's talking about the change that happens in the Christian, he says, when anyone turns to Christ, the veil is taken away, and they recognize Christ in the Old Testament. And then it says, now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And even when he talks about our being changed from one degree to the next, glory to glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Twice he says, before and after, talking about how we're transformed, he emphasizes it. It's through this radiating energy of the Spirit. One of the things that we've been doing now with COVID is we've been digitizing all our analog media. And what got us doing that is in the early days of this COVID thing, when we were just trying to do everything on the fly, one of the first Sundays when we were doing the Facebook Live, we just took my webcam, and that just left everything kind of fuzzy. So then the next week, I said, well, why don't we try to hook up my Canon DSLR? You know, there were these interchangeable lenses. And I researched how to do it. You had to buy this special adapter. Lo and behold, everyone else thought of that, and they were all sold out. So there were none of those things available. Except I found a really expensive version of that, one way more powerful than we needed. And it happened to be in the back room at Target on First Avenue. Out of this whole area, I found one thing. So I bought it, and we were able to have, that was Palm Sunday. We were able to have this really nice HD thing. Well, you know, we had already had this camera on purchase order because we were planning on doing live streaming before all this happened. And we were waiting for that, but eventually it came. But now I've got this expensive adapter. And I was looking at what can I do with this adapter, and I found out, well, this adapter is the perfect thing to use to hook up your VCR and to take, we have 30 tapes of home video, and to make them into digital files. And one of the things when you do that, though, is you have to play the video, right? So it's been kind of fun. We'll sit down some nights and we'll watch through an hour and a half of old video. And one of the things you encounter in old video like that are people who have died. My grandmother, Sue's dad. And the thing about it is when you're encountering these people who've died, and you hear them laugh, and these are long videos. I mean, we got 30 videos of at least 90 minutes each. So I mean, we were like crazy with the video, and you can begin to feel like they're right there, because their personality, their person, you might say their spirit, comes at you out of the media that's bringing it to you, and. The idea here in the Bible is that when someone turns to Christ, the veil is lifted, and as they begin to read the Old Testament, the reality of Christ radiates on. If our spirit can radiate out of a media like audio and video, how much more God's spirit, who is not just his spirit, but a very person. I talk about this with the kids. It's so amazing. We're kind of like God in that we can give birth to word, right? We can write a book, and it can outlast us. God's word is eternally begotten, and it's its own distinct identity. And we have a spirit. There's a spirit of a family, right? A family can be, the spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, just like the spirit of the family. But it's his own person, Father, Son, and Spirit, Trinity. It's a mystery. And when we turn to the Bible and we are being drawn to Christ and the veil's taken away, this spirit that is there radiates into our lives. And it begins to change us. Earlier in this chapter, he says, verse 2, you yourselves are our letter, written on our hearts, known and read by everybody. You show that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. God writes himself on you through the Spirit. You see, just like we would take a pen and that's the way, or you take something and you would chisel it into the stone and that's how you... How does God write in our lives and transform us? It's through the Spirit. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. It's the transformation of your heart by being in contact with this one who embodies the reality love. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates a brother or sister is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life residing in him. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us love not with words or speech, but actions and in truth. It's this love that's being written on us that was embodied in the life of Jesus. That is that knowledge in us that my life is being transformed, and I am going to, and it's being transformed into that which will last. Of course, this is Valentine's Day, so it's just perfect to be talking about love. And Valentine's Day, we often think about love in the form of attraction. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, we have a whole book of the Bible dedicated to that, the Song of Solomon or the Song of Songs. And that's almost a book that's somewhat embarrassing to read. There have been times in which both Jewish and Christian leaders have kind of sought to put that book aside because it's just a little too graphic. But it's a reminder that God isn't against the attraction of a husband and a wife to each other, and even physical attraction and finding those things exciting and beautiful. But the kind of love that is celebrated even more than that in the Bible is this love that was embodied in Christ. And the place where we find that love embodied in Christ spelled out is in 1 Corinthians 13, where he lists the things that last. And I love how he starts out that. He said, the very first thing when he talks about this love is patient. Or I like the King James, charity suffereth long. As we've been going through the videos, that's caused me to even want to, I had bought this thing to be able to digitize all of our old pictures. So I've been going through all of our old pictures. I got most of them all digitized. And so as those who are friends of me on Facebook know, I've been posting various pictures from when we were young. And that's gotten me thinking, when Sue and I were first dating and then got married. And that's gotten me thinking about marriage. You know, marriage is a wonderful blessing, but it also is a lot of hard work and can be very hard. And what's very hard about it is I've learned more and more. You know, you kind of start out in marriage, if they would just change, you know, this is where they need to be different. And the more you strive and you walk through life, the more you realize, I think a lot of this has been about me. I'm the one who needs to change. And what makes marriage difficult and hard is that coming to that awareness that I'm that person, and it's me, and God is dealing with me in this relationship of intimacy where all my warts and everything is being brought out. And this is the place of the hard work of forming me into the person Christ is calling me to be. More than any other place, it's right here. And that's what makes marriage both a blessing and but also hard work, if it really is to be what it's called to be. And that just dawned on me more and more. Here we've been married, it'll be in June, 32 years, and I think I'm only just beginning to understand a lot about what it's all about. But that's the other good part of what Paul said in here. He's saying God is changing us from one degree of glory to the next. It's a progressive project whereby as we keep turning to him and we keep in the journey, we find we're not the same person we were. I think Sue would agree with me. 32 years ago, I'm not the same person that I am today. And thank God, I'm not going to be the same person. I'm praying we'll have another 30 years or more, 30 years from now. And I'm future looking in our relationship. And the glorious thing about that is being able to look back and to see that and to realize he who began this good work in me, he's not going to give up on it and just let it go. He who began this good work in me and is changing me from one degree of glory to the next, who is suffering long with me because love suffers long, is going to see it to completion. And because I know he's going to see it to completion, I live with a sense of expectancy about what's going to happen when I get to be with him. You know, you can just hear John's expectancy. Dear friends, he says, we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. We don't even understand what it's going to be like. We have the beginnings of what love looks like in our lives. But the full manifestation of love that radiated such out of Jesus, his glory, that very word doxa in the Greek, glory, means the condition of being bright, shining, brightness, splendor, radiance. And Jesus, who is light from light, God from God, very God of very God, radiated out love. And when we see him, we'll be like him. We're going to shine like the stars in the night, the Bible says. And anyone who has this hope purifies himself as he is pure. They want more and more of that. Lord, make me more and more what I'm supposed to be, that I might have just a little glimpse, because the glimpse I get here still isn't what it's going to be like. Let me have more of that. Our closing hymn is "More Love to Thee, O Christ." And when we sing a song like that, "More Love to Thee," what we're really saying is, Lord, let me see how much you really love me. Because the more I know you love me, the more I love you, because we love because he first loved us. And how do you know God loves you? Well, I think that very first phrase is where you find it. Love is patient. Love, it's finding that the God who suffers long with your life and the ways you are not the way you should be, and he doesn't give up on you and he doesn't run away. That's how you know the person you married to loves you. Because they know all of the ugly stuff about you. They know all of the bad things that you do. But they suffer long with you. They're patient with you. Or as Paul will go on to say, it keeps no record of wrongs. It does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always hopes. It always perseveres. It's that persevering love revealed in God, who perseveres with us even when we keep blowing it, we keep going and having to relearn the old lesson again and again and again. And we find him at that point of when we're on the ground again and we failed again. And we find, he says, neither do I condemn you. Go and live a new life. Try it again. That he's changing us to be more like that. Because we then become patient with the people around us. That's why Jesus is so hard on those people who will not forgive other people, right? And that's why he gives the parable of the person who was forgiven $1 million, you know, and they go after that person who just got a little bit that owes him, and he says, that person doesn't get it. And that's why he says, you will not be forgiven if you don't forgive your neighbor. What is he saying? He's saying, if you don't forgive your neighbor, you really haven't received your forgiveness. Because if you really received your forgiveness, if you really realized how much you had been forgiven, you would look at everyone else's failings as just a little debt that they owed you. And if you really got how much God persevered with you and suffers long with you and doesn't give up on you, then you would offer that to all the people around you. You would be patient with them. You would not remember. See, that's, I think, the pernicious thing of this cancel culture is it's such a saying, you're unredeemable. We're going to throw you aside. That is absolutely not the Christian way. The Christian way is, all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There but by the grace of God go I, and it's only because God has persevered with me that I'm even here today, and my life is going the way it is, and everything I have I owe to God. And it's in that encounter of being forgiven that he's writing on our hearts a heart of forgiveness for others. And we're being transformed by that encounter of our being that person who people were going to throw the stones at, and him writing in the sand and saying, you know, you without sin cast the first stone. And our being the one who's saying, where are the people who condemn you? I don't condemn you. Now go. And when you encounter God there, then you go around and you're saying, how can I then throw stones at anybody else? Because I was there and they were all going to throw stones at me, but Jesus defended me and I'm going to defend them. And that person who becomes like Jesus is becoming all the more glorious. That's where this last verse 12 of chapter 3 comes in. It's a very interesting verse because literally it says it has this idea of a mirror being involved. If you look at some of the more literal translations, we who all behold in a mirror, but it could either mean behold in the mirror Jesus or reflect as a mirror. And I like what one of the study Bibles I read said about this. It says, beholding as in a mirror connotes reflecting as well as looking into. As we behold the glory of the Lord, we are continually transformed into the same image by the Spirit. We then, with ever-increasing glory, reflect what we behold. So the mirror is doing two things. On the one hand, we're looking at the reality of Christ. And that's why our old NIV here has verse 18. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect, and then it has a little letter there, and you go down, or contemplate. You can be both looking in the mirror, or you might be the mirror reflecting out. And in his commentary, N.T. Wright says of this passage, when a person looks at a congregation, and when they look at him, and when they look at one another, everybody is looking at somebody else in whose heart and life the Spirit, the Lord, has been at work to heal, to soften, to change, to give life. In other words, to give glory. And so it's that the images of we as Christians reflecting in all of our lives and in our life together this glory of Jesus by the way we're all suffering long with each other, taking care of each other's needs, being there for one another, and then us as a community, we're the organism that's to reflect out into the world God's true intention. God left the church for the world. I mean, we're the body of Christ. We're the ones in the midst of all of this division and all of this fear and all of this mistrust who as a community say, I'm not going to live that way in this community. We're going to forgive each other. We're going to love each other. We're going to go after each other. We're going to care for one another. And we're not going to have that spirit here. We're going to be the place, the one place in the world where that's not found, and people are going to see in that the glory of Jesus, the love of God that was manifest in Jesus Christ. And he gave us to the world to be that light. That's why he said, you are the light of the world. This is the light that's going to shine into the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Don't put your light under a bushel. Get out there and be the church. And that's why in the second half of John's gospel, the book of glory, he said, this is my commandment, that you love one another. This is what I want you to be doing. This is what it's all about. You will fulfill my command to you if you're that community that embodies what's in me. But again, the source of having that in our lives is as we keep going to Jesus ourselves, and we find in him that forgiveness for all of our failings. And so we forgive because he forgave us. And then it's in that process of continually going to them that he's writing on us that changed life that lasts forever. And because we have that, we're bold. We're not ever going to back down on that. We're going to continue to preach it and teach it and say that it's in that man, Jesus. It's in the life that he lived that real life is found. Would you bow me as we pray? Father, we thank you for the gift that appeared in Jesus Christ, the gift of the love that appeared. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to draw us to him. And we trust that as we're being drawn to him over the course of our lives, you are making us into the people you want us to be. For we receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand for our hymn of consecration, number 634, More Love to Thee. Thank you. may we come to love him more and more, because if we come to love him more and more, that means we recognize how much we're recognizing more and more how much he loves us, that we're recognizing the extent of his love and loving us in our most unlovable places and not abandoning us, but suffering along with us, enduring and being patient with us when and we're insufferable. He suffers long. And may then we then turn and extend that gift to other people and show that love to them. And when we do that, we radiate the glory of the Lord. And that doesn't go away. That lasts. And he who begins this work in us, he's going to bring it to its completion when we shine out for all of eternity. And the person who has that hope, they live as bold people because they have a message to share that's worth sharing. As you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine down upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.